Well, that's an example of what the wind was like on my last shift. The village agent had told us it was about 20 miles an hour from the northeast. It was from the northeast, that's for sure. I filmed that clip after editing my 30 seconds in Alaska piece, which is coming up later. First, what you're looking at, fuselage on its side. I probably can't see it. I just used a quarter of a sheet of plywood, 2 by 4 feet. Rather than make some kind of fancy rotisserie, I just mounted it up to the firewall locations. Keeps the side of the fuselage off the ground, which is really all I need. So the main point of this episode is to get both sides covered on the fuselage. I have the pieces cut and I have the adhesive already on the fabric, but I still need to put the adhesive on the framework before I can get started. And of course, the interesting part is the engine. I've made a little bit of progress on that. So welcome to episode 31. All right, so at the end of the last episode, I had just finished picking up this powder-coated mount, and I also got the landing gear powder-coated. I'll show that later on. Took the engine off of the engine mount over there with some help, put it face down on the foam so that I could put on this motor mount, test fit the exhaust, test fit the fuel injection system. So the rubber isolators and hardware is attaching the motor mount to the back of the engine right now. Those need to be torque to the proper value, which I just got that number yesterday. Then I need to use the cotter pins. So the exhaust system, you'll notice it does not stick straight down, which actually works out just fine in my case. One of the main reasons is that insulation in the Kitfox, this is the lowest point of the firewall. If I want the oil tank to be centered, then the whole thing would have to stick down below the fuselage. But if I tuck it up, what's going to be on the left side, because keep in mind we're behind the engine right now, that also puts the oil filler and dipstick off to the left side of the cowl, which is a good location. I know asymmetrical designs bother some people. They don't bother me at all. That'll put the stacks sticking out to the right side, oil tank over here. I think that'll all work fine. Try to film it. I think I had the camera turned off. So this is take number two. This is called the adapter right here. It has both the injector nozzles, and this is the distributor. It gets fuel from, I think, this fitting right here, a piece of AN4 hose. This right here is what determines the air density. It is checking the pressure differential between incoming air and what's inside, and then it adjusts the fuel mixture according to that. You still have a mixture control. That's just how this goes. And of course, originally I had intended to mount this servo directly straight out the back onto this adapter. But then I also wanted to explore this 90 degree option, and I like the 90 degree option for a couple reasons. One is that having this thing point straight back meant that the air filter was going to be difficult to access for servicing, and that's actually about the only downside. Anyway, so, but this mount, through either design skill or luck or whatever, it's going to work out so I could have it oriented out. I could do it up, left, right. Up is not going to happen because that just puts more crap up on top of the cowl that I got to look around. Out to the left and right, I'm choosing right because based on the direction of the propeller spinning, I tend to see more debris getting picked up and launched off the left side of the airplane that it could then get ingested into a scoop on the left side. So this descending blade, less likely to ingest, at least that's my crazy theory. But this is going to allow me to put on a air filter and then a scoop out the side. Oh, and for anybody curious, if I haven't mentioned it in a while, going to the fuel injection means I don't have to worry about a heat muff or carb heat. And for cabin heat, I'm actually going to use electric gear like I use for riding my motorcycle. The plug-in 12-volt jacket or even just a vest for both people on my motorcycle. I've been riding as low as 14 degrees Fahrenheit and I am okay. So certainly in an airplane with a windshield and cabin doors, that kind of heat's going to be just fine. And I do not have to worry about carbon monoxide and all that crap, plumbing. And of course, this airplane does not have a radiator, so that's not an option. Suppose I could do something freaky with an oil cooler, but not on the list right now. And of course, fuselage laying on its side. I thought I was going to come out here with my fabric, which, as I probably said already, I have the fabric cut. I have the adhesive. It's already in the fabric, but and that's been stored in my warm home. But now I need to get the adhesive on the airplane, two coats, let it dry, get the fabric on. So it has to be a straight shot because it is mid-40s, almost 50 degrees right now. And it cannot get below 40 degrees until the stuff has been thoroughly activated with the heat gun and the iron. So I had my work cut out for me. One of the things I skipped, thought I had taken care of already, was the ELT mount. I had done this piece of angle right here with the two Adele clamps, and it was probably okay. But I wanted to add this third leg today, third clamp, riveted that together. It's nice and strong. Now I need a coax cable about 30 inches long to go from this bottom of the antenna over to the ELT location. That'll be about perfect. Anyway, so I'm gonna heat up the hangar and get this piece of fabric on. Well, I did not run the GoPro for any of this part yesterday, but I did get the right side of the fuselage covered. I thought for a while I had really screwed it up because there was a lot of bagginess in all this, but you keep up the heat and you get it done. Actually came out pretty good. I researched this morning, I looked in the better tips and tricks that Lars put out, and I wanted to make sure I wasn't getting used too much heat. I had originally shrunk most of the excess out with the iron, set at like 395, and then when I came back with the heat gun set at 395 degrees Fahrenheit, then I came back later with the iron set at 140 because the heat gun isn't super even about the way it applies, or at least I wasn't even, and I was worried that 140 was pushing it. It's not. He says to come back at 150 to 160 degrees Celsius, and his only warning is that above 200 you can start to discolor the fabric if you don't run a double layer of white paper towel or some kind of lint-free cotton cloth, and I've got some of that stuff too. So anyway, the iron is heating up, and I'll go over this one more time and then get some help flipping this thing over. You know, for some reason in my head, I was gonna not have these gaps, and I don't know why I thought that, because everybody else has them. You get some gaps and you gotta deal with it. And I just wrapped to this point right here. I did not wrap it around the corner. I'm gonna get some of that molding that goes over here anyway, so I'm not super worried about it. I've got some white touch-up paint. This will be my little secret pretty soon. And then here's where, once you get the heat on, Oratex can actually stretch like 15%, I think I read just this morning. So here's the next problem. This is pretty mild, which is why I turned the camera on, because otherwise I'd probably screw it up. So again, I'm going to shrink some out here. And then by hitting it with some heat, maybe pull it tight enough that I can rub a little bit and chase out any wrinkle that was going to fall in the way. Same thing down here, getting a little bit worse. So I'm already stuck here and here, so I've got to get rid of this material. And I'm touching super light when I do this. Just trying to see if it's ready to heat in some. And so it's smooth right on this tangent point, and I'm just gonna kind of feather it a little bit, see if it's ready. I am pushing this. This could turn into be a wrinkle if I don't do it right. So now I'm just going to go out here and heat this up. Get some to shrink. Just dragging this, not even an ounce of pressure on here. Now a little bit more pressure. And no wrinkle. Couple of tiny spots down here. And that's a wrap for tonight. I'll come in tomorrow morning. There'll be a few wrinkles. I'll hit it with heat again. Key point is that every place there's adhesive, it's now been activated with the iron or the heat gun and the felt blade. Now there's a couple spots back here. I noticed it wasn't sticking at all, which means there wasn't adhesive on either one or both parts. I think all it takes is adhesive not being on one part and it's not gonna stick very well at all. So in that case, I just stop. I didn't really shrink this, if you might have noticed. So I'll come back tomorrow, I'll peel this, I'll put some adhesive in here, peel it back, let it dry, do that a couple coats, and then seal that down. I have to get the rudder cable fished out, which I did on the other side, and of course it did an ugly job of that. So again, good thing I have these little rudder cable shrouds that some of the guys on the forum are using. Just copying the people that are smarter than I am. So another thing I should note is that I'm using their B-grade material, their defective material. It's a lot cheaper. The number of flaws that you can see are pretty small. I did notice, in fact, you might be able to see it in the light here. Most of it's gone, but there's some, looks almost like unidirectional. And then there's a couple of rectangles, like there was a patch or something sitting on there, a sticker or something like that that made a mark. Most of it's gone away, and then if you've seen my goofy paint job I have in mind, I'm gonna end up with a big fat belly band stripe here and a number and all that junk anyway, so it doesn't really matter. In general, I think this is the cost-effective material to go with. Pretty happy with that. I'm putting in way more flaws than the fabric has, so there's all that. So the fabric is on bottom and both sides. Too soon for hi-fis. I can't put the landing gear back on yet because I have to do the edge tapes at least along the sides of the fuselage. One of the other places a lot of people are encouraged to tape, just like you would with a legacy system, is any place the structure comes into contact with the fabric. And in this case, I'm also bonded to these tubes. There's a big lattice work underneath here. It's going to get pretty busy. I stuck down these two tapes last night and then called it quits because I wasn't sure what temperature I should be using, and I'm glad that I used a low temperature to put them on, then went home and read up. So these temperatures are much lower. You can tack them in place at 90 degrees Celsius, and then the high end is 120 degrees Celsius. So if you used your regular 140 plus or the super hot iron, you're gonna shrink this stuff up and destroy it. Lars makes mention sometime of sacrificial pieces, and if you pull this stuff off cold, it will destroy the fabric underneath. But because it goes on at a lower temperature, it also comes off at a lower temperature. It comes off at a temperature which is, I'll have to see if I can find it, put it on here, but low enough that you could peel it back off and not damage the fabric underneath or cause it to detach from the structure. So in other words, you could peel this off and redo it at some point. Could I get away without doing these tapes? I probably could. When I looked underneath Nate's plane recently, the one he built, he did not have any tapes and didn't look like he was suffering any negative effects from that. But also, I have no experience with these tapes, and a good place to start is underneath the airplane where you're not going to see again, and then I can work my way up to the stuff which is visible. And even though it's going to be kind of crazy in this part of the fuselage right here, all these pieces I have cut, again, here's a piece of framework, there's a horizontal line, these, there's a angled one here, and then several going across, and then I'll get back to this long one down the middle. So lots of practice before I get to the stuff that's visible. The other thing is, if in the long run I decided I did need these tapes down here, it would be better to do it when it's fresh and new versus getting underneath an airplane when it's got all kinds of exhaust residue, oil, grass, bug guts, all that kind of stuff. So this material is completely unlike working with the Oratex 6000, which has no adhesive, and that's why you have to put the adhesive on it. This stuff has the peel-off backing, and it has adhesive on one side, which is already there. It's also not sensitive to temperature at all, so it doesn't care that it's being stored in freezing conditions even. You put it down and iron it, get all the wrinkles out. Having the adhesive on one side only makes it super easy, and it also gets away from having any risk of having the adhesive bleed out from the edges of the tape. I got pretty lucky when I did this because I masked off where it was going to, and then I trimmed off using just a little spacer and a razor blade, which you'll probably have seen already in the video at this point. It's not perfect. There is a trick where you can, just like I did on the wing, you can come back and paint a little bit of the Oratex adhesive on here, and then when you cover it up and you melt it, it helps bridge that gap a little bit so the seam's not as visible. And speaking of things that are visible, you've been watching the video and you don't see me mention it. This stuff right here is not lumps of glue or places I screwed anything up. This is a weld bead from underneath. And disclaimer, this is a SkyStar welded fuselage. This is not a current Kitfox production. I have seen people make remarks about the weld bead being visible and they know it's gonna print through like this, so they grind it off. Being an engineer type, I'm really reluctant to grind it off and have to retreat the surface so it doesn't rust. I'm just going to live with the fact that most fabric-covered airplanes are a little bit lumpy. They're a little bit flawed, just like myself. So anyway, so if you've seen that, and I didn't bring it up, that's what it is. Here's weld bead. Here's another one. Here's a wrinkle I need to shrink out. This is the aluminum tube, so it's not going to have any of that. And then you get all these metal weldments, which are part of the landing gear system. And what else was I going to say? Oh yeah, driving out here just a little while ago. So this right here is where the one of my ELT antennas is going to come through. I'm still grouchy that I have to have two. My Stratus ESGI transponder that had my Citabria just used the one antenna. This one has to have two for the Echo UAT and for the Sandia STX-165. So it's going to have one here. The other one has to be at least 3 feet away, so I'm actually going to have it poke through the stainless part of the firewall where it comes over, and hopefully that works out. Anyway, just driving out here an hour ago, see another weld bead, looks beautiful. I just remembered the hole that needs to be cut because of the header tank, which is underneath here, so it's going to be a sump drain for the header tank. And if I had any firing neurons left, I would have done that hole and the stuff that goes to it before I covered this side of the fuselage. But that ship sailed, so I'll get to do it the hard way through here, which is not going to be impossible. Actually, not too bad. I'll have to go back to work tomorrow, so I'm just finishing up. Trying to get some of these other tapes on here. Had a few places where I wish I would have done it differently, but it's coming out fine. One last thing is these windows. I asked on the forum of whether people just cut them off net or if they trimmed a little bit of excess and wrapped them around the corner. People have done it both ways, but it seems like the safest bet is to cut like a quarter to 3/8 inch of excess and wrap it around, so that's what I did. Came out all right. And that's going to have to be it for this episode. Come back in February, I'll get these edge tapes, which I now have a plan for, on the bottom. Get my landing gear back on here. I'm going to order a T3 tailwheel and go ahead and mount that thing up. Get this thing right set up. See you next month. I got a little bit further than I thought I was going to. I got every one of these tapes angled and straight across. Dug around because of the way I had these laid out. I needed one that was a little bit wider, and it turns out I had a roll 3-inch, so I used that. I got the one all the way down the center line. All these are done, so now I need to do the one on the side here. And of course, with got a lot of practice using this stuff right here. Got it stuck down with 90 degrees Celsius to tack it in place, get it nice and smooth, and then come back with the 120 degree in the iron, and then of course the heat gun and the felt blade in areas where there's contour.